Welcome in to the Blue White Weekend Looking Through Time special. I'm Jon Gross.
And I'm Matt Freiler.
It was the turn of the millennium when he succeeded the late, great Fran Fischer in the broadcast booth. Now, as Penn State prepares for the annual Blue White Spring Game, he'll begin his 20th season calling Penn State football. We are honored to be joined by the voice of the Nittany Lions, Steve Jones, in studio. Steve, thanks so much for joining us.
Jon, Matt, great to be with both of you.
Awesome. Thanks, Steve. So we both grew up listening to you well before we became students here. Okay. And you also have an infinite amount of memories to share over your time in the booth. So what Jon and I did is we discussed our top 10, because we've been watching for, you know, since you've been calling games, and we put it together. Let's go ahead and take a look. How about it?
Okay, let's go.
Let's start back in 2002, entering his senior day.
It's to Larry Johnson, left side, 40, 35, 30, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown! 2K for LJ!
Larry Johnson gained 1,000 yards in the month of November that year. But when you go into a game like that, you have to realize he needed 268 yards to get to 2,000. So you don't walk in there thinking he's going to get to 2,000 yards today, let alone do it in the first half. He ended up gaining 279 yards all in the first half. As for saying 2K for LJ, I don't script what I say, ever. I think if you're comfortable doing that, you do that. I'd rather have it be natural. So it just because we'd gone through the year 2000, everybody was talking about 2K all this and 2K that. That's how I came up with it, 2K for LJ, and I didn't think about it until he crossed the goal line. I thought, that'd be a cool thing to say. If you blow it, you blow it, okay? If you do it right, people remember it for years, so I got lucky on that one.
Yeah. I'd say that was one of your more iconic calls, 2K for LJ.
And only 9 players before him to do it, so a huge moment.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to just a few years later. After back-to-back finishes in the cellar of the Big Ten, the pressure was on for Joe Paterno in 2005. After a 3-0 start, the Nittany Lions faced their first tough test of the season in their conference opener at Northwestern. They're trailing 29-27 with under a minute to play. Penn State was out to prove they were, in fact, back from the dead.
Have to get something here. Third down, 6, Northwestern 36. Here comes the blitz. Robinson delivers downfield for Derek Williams. Wide open at the 10. Derek cuts inside to the 5. Touchdown, Penn State.
That was Derek Williams' first career touchdown. And Penn State took over at the 15-yard line. And Penn State had a 4th and 15. And Michael Robinson delivered a pass over the middle to Isaac Smolko for 20 yards and a first down. That actually was the pivotal play on the drive where when you're sitting there, Jack Ham and I looked at each other and thought, okay, now you've got something going here. Now you've changed the dynamic. You've changed the momentum. And that fourth down play is one of the more important plays. They went back to it, by the way, in the Orange Bowl against Florida State, that same play. Then they get to this, and it was an all-out blitz. And when Derek caught it, first of all, Penn State picked it up. Michael delivered it right on the money, and then Derek cut inside the guy and got into the end zone. So he gets his first career touchdown. It puts Penn State in front. They win the game.
Always hard to get a win at Northwestern, especially at, 11 a.m. Central time, that game probably kicks off.
Yeah. We've had some interesting ones there over the years. I mean, Joe got his 323rd there, too. Tying Bear Bryant's record back in 2001. So it's been a place that's also had some great memories.
Right.
Well, speaking of late game drama, really could not get any more dramatic than September 23rd, 2017. Fourth-ranked Penn State travels to Iowa City, a primetime game in Kinnick Stadium. An instant classic came it down to literally the final second.
The pass, blitz coming, in the end zone, throws, got it, touchdown, Penn State, Jawan Johnson, and the Nittany Lions at the wire win it.
If you look at that game, Penn State gained over 500 yards in total offense, up and down the field, and just could never finish until they get to this drive. James Franklin is meticulous in his preparation, and they work on situational football all the time, and that two-minute drill is a part, obviously, of situational football. Every coach does that. There was a big fourth down pass play to Saeed Blacknall on that drive that kept that drive alive. So you could talk about what Isaac Smolko did. Blacknall did that in this game as well. When they got to this point, I remember how I set it up, and it wasn't a part of that call there, but right before that I said, look, here it is, it's win it or lose it right here. So you have to set up the situation, and so I set the situation up, and you pick it up as quickly as you can. It was Jawan that caught it, but the most important part is that was a touchdown and that, you know, they took the lead. Somebody said to me after this, is, you know, we thought you'd go more crazy. I said, how much more excited do you want me to be? I said, but you have to have a controlled excitement when you do this because you have to know what you're saying. You can't go out there and be insane about something. Oh, my God. It's like, please. Okay, I got it. I know what the final score is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was certainly an all-timer. So we move on now to number 7. The year was 2008. Penn State's new spread HD offense was lighting up the Big Ten. And although the Nittany Lions were unbeaten and ranked 3rd in the nation, a trip to the Horseshoe for a primetime game against Ohio State is never easy.
3rd and inches. Prior quarterback sneaks right side, fumbles the football, losing the turf. Snow losing the turf, they scramble for it. And as they dive all over the place, Penn State recovers. Penn State recovers the football.
Navarro Bowman, Mark Rubin. Penn State had not won in there in 30 years, 1978. I was at the game in 1978 as a student, and Penn State went in there. Penn State was ranked, ended up being ranked number one that year, lost the national championship game to Alabama, but they won the game 19-0. Jack Hamm and I have always said that to us, that is one of the more significant wins we've ever called at Penn State. We've always said that because of the location, the meaning of the game. It was also a game where Pat Devlin came into the game and played very well, but you know the irony is he didn't complete a single pass. Pat Devlin did not complete a pass in that game. He was 0-3, but he threw a ball over the middle to Derek Williams, and it was a pass interference call, and it set Penn State up, and then Devlin scored on a quarterback sneak. That was all set up by this play right here. Navarro Bowman, Mark Rubin combining with Ohio State at midfield. Ohio State still had a chance, though. They got the ball back, they moved, and then on the final play of the game, Pryor threw the ball into the end zone. Lydell Sargent picked it off in the end zone. Penn State won the game, and I remember sitting on the bus in the parking lot saying, finally. They came to Columbus and they won, finally. Now, Sean Lee was out that year, right? So Bowman and Lee were gonna be the 1-2 punch at linebacker, and Lee got hurt in spring practice on a pass play over the middle. And Bowman was just a phenomenal linebacker. I mean, and you can see what he's done in the NFL.
Yeah, Penn State that year going on to win the Big Ten championship.
Yeah, they got onto the Rose Bowl. Yeah.
Making our way through the list, now to number 6, we have our first clip from the Bill O'Brien era at Penn State. Of course, banned from the postseason, facing harsh NCAA sanctions. Penn State battled through and played an instant classic against Michigan in front of a raucous whiteout crowd, trailing by a score less than 30 seconds to go. This play will live in Penn State lore. Christian Hackenberg to Allen Robinson en route to a 4 overtime victory.
Steps up of the pocket, delivers it long and deep downfield for Robinson. Leaps high in the air. He's got it! Inside the 5 at the pylon. It's at the 1-yard line with 27 seconds to go. What a catch!
Well, here's your situation. Down 7. 80 yards in front of you with your 18-year-old quarterback at the controls. That's what I said. He threw a pass to the sideline to Allen Robinson where he somehow kept a toe in bounds for a first down. He then hit Brandon Mosley Felder downfield at the 37-yard line to set this play up. It was in between two, but there was a separation between the two. It was a really well-thrown ball, but Brandon really made a heck of a play on the ball, and that set this play up. Hackenberg then scored on a quarterback sneak. And then finally in the 4th overtime, Penn State went for it on 4th down. And we asked Bill O'Brien after the game why. He says, you know what? I looked around and said, look, let's just win it or lose it now. Right? He got the first down, and then eventually Bill Belton scored to win it. And it was one of the great wins.
Yeah, that was a huge one.
You mentioned that Mosby Felder catch. I think that was the even more improbable catch between that and the Robinson catch.
Well, that's why when we relive these things, I think I brought up a few things people forget about. Because to me, that was significant because you can't make the play to Robinson unless he makes that play. It's the equivalent in basketball of having the hockey assist, the pass that leads to the pass that leads to the basket. And that's what the Mosby Felder play happened to be. It put them in a position where tying became possible.
And then a couple of missed kicks in overtime. Eventually, Penn State takes the win.
Oh, I'm an expert on the missed kick in overtime. I did the Orange Bowl.
Might get to that one a little later. So now we're on to the top five of our favorite Penn State football moments since 2000. Our next clip combines two moments 10 years apart. Both cemented a legacy of the most winningest coach in college football history, with every win coming at Penn State.
Design run by Mills, 35, hurdles a man to the 40, 45, 50, Mills to the 40, far sideline, 40, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Zach Mills, a 69-yard run.
The reason no one has won more than him.
42-yard attempt for overtime, center of the field. Good snap, put down, kick by Demke's on its way, the kick by Demke is, it's the upright, no good, and Penn State wins the game. At Beaver Stadium. They'll never forget Joe Paterno's 409th, will they?
To me, personally, Joe was very special. I feel it was an absolute privilege to have called the last 12 seasons of his career. I knew him for 32 years. He could not have treated me any better. And the great moments, the Zach Mills run, Penn State was down 27-9 in that game, and he hurled Mike Doss. And after he cleared him, he went 69 yards for a touchdown. And then eventually, Zach threw a touchdown pass to Eric McCoo. And he passed Bear Bryant 324. And I was there in 1981 when Bear Bryant won number 314 to tie Amos Alonzo Stagg. In between was not shown was his 400th. And Penn State was down 21-0 in that game against Northwestern. Scored before the end of a half on a touchdown pass from Matt McLoy to Brett Brackett, and they said, you know what, now they've got a chance. And they rallied and won that game 35-21. And I remember exactly what I said after the game. Again, I don't script things, but I said, you'll never see this again. One man, one school, 400 wins. 409, Penn State was down in the game. And McLoy engineered a drive, hit two big pass plays to Derek Moy. There was a pass interference call at the goal line involving Derek Moy, and then Silas Redd scored on the left side. Now they had to survive this, and Derek Demke had not missed a field goal all season. He'd been 10 for 10. And when he came off his foot, you could just tell the ball was sliding, and it hit the upright, and it fell no good, and he passed Eddie Robinson on the all-time list. That's why 409 was so significant, because Eddie Robinson had 408. And what people forget is before the kick, the entire student section moved behind the goalpost to see if they could affect Demke kicking the ball. So that was obviously bittersweet because that was also his last game as the head coach. There aren't many coaches that leave the game on a 7-game winning streak.
True. Hey, one thing I've always wondered about that 409 game, Derek Moy comes in for the final drive. He'd been injured.
Actually, that's mythology. Derek Moy actually entered the game in the third quarter.
Really?
Everybody says here he comes off. Because I even know in the Penn State football, and he comes in. He entered the game in the third quarter. Right? Now, he didn't play every down, but But he came in the third, he played a few plays in the fourth, and of course in the last drive he was in all the way through. So that's a bit of college football mythology.
Oh, God, you cleared it up. That's why he's here, right?
Makes the story even better. Earlier in the show at number 9, we saw Penn State take down Northwestern in the final seconds to get their first big win of the 2005 season. 2 weeks later, Penn State was back at home, set to take on the 6th-ranked Ohio State Buckeyes in the most highly anticipated matchup of the decade. College game day was there. Massive whiteout crowd. Joe Paterno's Nittany Lions were ready to prove to the nation that they were back.
Smith back to pass. Pressure. Down he goes. Tom Holly fumbles the football. Penn State recovers. Snap action. The Nittany Lions defense comes up with the signature play of this game.
Jack and I felt going into the game, Penn State was going to win the game because we could just tell they were just that good. And the bottom line is Penn State was able to play most of the game with the lead. And that really was important. Troy Smith, who eventually won the Heisman Trophy, threw an interception because Paul Posluszny dropped back into his zone. He had to throw the ball over Posluszny, and Calvin Lowry picked it off and he ran back to the 2-yard line. And eventually Michael Robinson scored. They scored with Derek Williams running the ball in. Posluszny had a big sack in the game. And, you know, Ohio State played really well. That's why this was really impressive, because Penn State played better. But if you want to know what today, the genesis of what the true whiteout is at Penn State, you know, yeah, they'd done it before with student sections and things like that, but that was this game. This is the game that told the country what we had already known, that Penn State was back. And the sack by Tom at the end where he flips him on his head, right? And then Scott Paxton then, of course, recovered it. And, you know, this stadium's bouncing up and down, all right? Which means the press box is bouncing up and down. And we're in a commercial break, so we didn't say this on the air. Jack says to me, he says, are we safe up here? I said, Jack, I'm an announcer, not an engineer. I have no idea.
And I'm glad we had your call for that moment, because the TV actually said Ohio State recovers the fumble. So everyone's wondering, what? Like, we thought Paxton had it, and he did. He, in fact, did.
So finally got one right.
Well, while that 2005 win against Ohio State ended up propelling the Nittany Lions to a Big Ten championship, it was well before the days when the crown was decided by an annual championship game in Indianapolis. In James Franklin's third year at the helm, Penn State got a chance to represent the Big Ten East Division and win their fourth Big Ten title since joining the conference in 1993.
Buried, it's close. It's all spot. I don't know if he got it. The Big Ten championship lies on a measurement.
Did he get it?
It's a significant win in my history of being around Penn State football, because James Franklin in the third year gets everybody around here excited about what Penn State football is currently, what Penn State football is going to be. I'm a big James Franklin guy. I think he's done a marvelous job here. And the one thing that you wanted to do with Wisconsin is to eventually get to the lead, because they were playing with their backup quarterback. They'd gone back and forth on quarterbacks. But you wanted them to have to throw the ball to win. And he hit Barkley on the wheel route where he beat T.J. Watt. And that put them in front. They could have put it away, and they had to settle for a field goal. So the possibility of a touchdown to tie here was still in place. But Corey Clement, who now plays for the Eagles, they gave it to him. And the same combination, I've got a feeling we're going to see this combination coming up here, of Marcus Allen and Grant Haley combined to make that stop, which is the same combination we'll see a little bit later.
Wow, another great finish there as the Nittany Lions and James Franklin captures his first Big Ten championship. We're down to our final two favorite moments of Penn State football since 2000. Steve, what do you think of the list so far? We have a couple more, but first date, your thoughts?
Oh, you guys did a great job picking the list. I'm just reacting because I didn't obviously see the list ahead of time. You have no idea if anything I'm saying is right.
All right, let's move on to number two on our list. It's the third moment from that magical 2005 season. 11-1, Penn State had clinched a Big Ten championship and was BCS bowl bound. Their opponent, well, the ACC champion, Florida State Seminoles, coached by the runner-up to Joe Paterno when it came to wins, one and only Bobby Bowden. The two legends battled that night through three overtimes, but Paterno came out with the last laugh.
We were on the air for 7.5 hours. We started at 6:30 at night with the pregame show. The kickoff was after 8 some point, and the postgame show ended at 2 a.m.
Is that the longest you've been on for a single game?
That's the longest I've been on for a single game. It's the only triple overtime game ever in the BCS or college football playoff era. Michael Robinson had Jordan Norwood on the sideline, and then he threw a pass in the end zone to Ethan Kilmer. That is one of the truly great catches I have ever seen in my career. And that put Penn State in front at the half. So now you get to the overtime. Penn State scores right away in overtime. Austin Scott had come off the bench in that game. Tony Hunt got hurt in the first series of the game. He hurt his ankle. And Austin Scott had played, and Scott had over 100 yards rushing. So he scores in overtime. Okay, great. Well, then Florida State scores. Okay, great. Now we get into the field goal part. And Florida State misses a field goal. Florida State has one hit the upright that would have won the game. So then Kevin Kelly came out, and on that game-winning field goal, it was second down. And the call was a fake. Right? Wow. Ganner was holding. Yes, the one that's associated with the Jonas Brothers. Right? And the call was a fake. But it is the responsibility of the holder to come out. And if they're not lined up the way you want, he can call it off. Well, they had lined up one way the entire game. And again, it's second down, so you're not going to be hurt by the fake if, you know, unless you turn it over. Well, they lined up differently. So he looked back at Kevin Kelly and said, "We're kicking it." And he snuck that baby just inside the right upright, right?
True freshman, right?
And I remember I referred to it as the epic of the Orange Bowl, right? You know, the epic of the Orange Bowl is what I said. We went to a commercial break, and I said, we can all go to sleep now.
It was a school night. I remember that one back in fourth or fifth grade or whatever it was.
I remember Joe Paterno, we interviewed him, and he said, it's past my bedtime.
You saw his reaction after the game. He was like, we're done. Like, we got this over with. Well, we've ran through most of the list with 9 moments from 8 different seasons. But now we're finally at number one. You have any guesses on this one, Steve? I know you referred to it earlier.
I think we're going to go with the Grant Haley, Marcus Allen play.
Yeah, we don't have to set this one up because it speaks for itself. This is our number one favorite Penn State football moment since 2000.
It's a 41-yard attempt. Far hash, put down. Kick is up, it's blocked. On the turn, picked up by Haley. Haley to the 50, the 40, 30, 25, 20. Haley 10, 5. Touchdown, Penn State. Marcus Allen blocked it. And Grant Haley takes it to the house. And the Nittany Lions electrify Beaver Stadium and take the lead with 4:27 to go.
Well, if it's going to be that long, there also means the possibility of being low. And I saw right away that it was Marcus Allen that blocked it. But I decided to pick the ball up, because if you notice at the end, I mentioned Marcus Allen blocked it. Well, I knew right away he blocked it. I could see it. But because Grant picked it up and I saw all this green grass, I'm thinking, he might go. And then I'm watching the fastest punter in the history of man, yeah, right? Yeah. Because Cameron Johnston, who now punts for the Eagles, right, was the holder. And he's got this angle, and I'm thinking, Grant Haley's a 4.35 40 guy. And I'm thinking, come on. I'm thinking to myself, look, you can't root him into the end zone, but come on, let's go. And you know, when he gets there, that was because of everything Penn State had been through. Everything. I felt that moment was the release of pure joy by Penn State fans in the stadium. They hadn't had a release of pure joy in that stadium in years. It had been a release of us against the world. You know, winning in overtime in 2012 on senior day against Wisconsin. Yeah, great win, but us against the world. Beating Michigan in the game you referenced earlier in four overtimes. Us against the world. This was the first time where I felt that all of a sudden everybody could just release and be just happy about everything. They picked up a big win. They had an opportunity to put themselves in the race, you know, to play for a national championship. They put themselves in a position at minimum to win the Big Ten championship. That's why I always talk about that controlled excitement. Well, in the controlled excitement, you know, he scores. You mentioned who blocked it. You mentioned the atmosphere. You mentioned how much time is left. Now everybody knows, okay, they got to negotiate 427 to go here. And they did it, and that was the game that I think told everybody, you know what? James Franklin's going to be here a long time, and he means business.
Yeah, and certainly the longest 427 I've ever seen. Continuing with the theme, 05, 08, 16, beat Ohio State, win a Big Ten championship.
Well, so. It's always been important because that, you know, you could talk about the Ohio State-Michigan series all you want, but Ohio State and Penn State's done a lot more to determine Big Ten championships over the years, one way or the other. Hey, because you look at the last couple of years, 1 point Ohio State win there, 1 point Ohio State win here. I mean, the Penn State-Ohio State game has done more to determine Big Ten championships in the last 15 years than Ohio State and Michigan have.
So we run through our top 10. One moment we didn't even want to rank because it was just so special. 2001, Penn State opens against Miami, and Adam Talaferro enters the field against the odds. But we did want to get your reaction on that moment.
Adam Talaferro always played right corner, always, never, and he had hurt his thumb in a scrimmage in Beaver Stadium because he came up and he cut down Eric McCoo for a loss, and in the play he hurt his thumb. And I remember walking out with him that day and he was like, geez, it was bad. Well, he finally gets back into action, and Tom Bradley, and again, you can't regret these things, but he's always regretted. He put Adam into the game against Ohio State late, and he put him at left corner. And he's always said, why did I put him at left corner? That's why. And, you know, he just went in, his helmet's down, he hit him, and all of a sudden he's not moving. Now, Wayne Sebastianelli, the Penn State team doctor, saved his life that day. Well, we can't go to a commercial break, and Jack and I were on for 20 minutes while they're tending to this, and we're not quite sure how bad it is. We know it's bad, but to what extent, we don't know. Well, I had to go down to the locker room to get the bag, and Joe was in there, and I could see on Joe's face that this was devastating. That's when I really knew. We didn't talk, we didn't say anything. So we get on the plane to go back, and Joe's fighting back and forth about, you know, should I just stay? Should I go back with the team? What should I do? So this is what he did. He said, look, you know, I'm the head football coach of the team. So he went back with the team and immediately got on a plane and flew right back, right, to be there with him. So he did it right away. So he came back with his team, took care of that part, boom, went right back to Columbus. He then comes out and he walks out and the place goes crazy, and then he jogged. When he got to the goal line, he jogged 10 yards, 10, 15 yards, just to show everybody he could do it.
Yeah.
And, you know, with his parents, you know, his family, great people. You know, he goes on to become an attorney, board of trustee here at one point at Penn State. He's just a very special guy. So, anybody who wears 43 should understand the legacy of what 43 is. It may have been only four games, but Adam Talaferro is the greatest comeback story I ever saw.
Thanks for tuning in to the Blue White Weekend Looking Through Time Special. For Matt Freiler and Steve Jones, I'm Jon Gross. Don't forget to tune in to the Penn State Sports Network on Saturday, as Steve will be live with his broadcast partner, Jack Hamm, for the Blue White Game. So long.